In 1887, Political Science Quarterly published Woodrow Wilson's The Study of Administration. This article stood as a call to action for those interested in policy to begin working on everything that happens the moment after a bill is signed, that work consisting of administrative rather than political content. The stress that Wilson put between political and administrative questions came to be known as the politics-administration dichotomy. Before this article, administration was seen as more of an afterthought, but Wilson asserts that this was not an accident. In all fairness, up until Wilson's time, the human population was relatively low. Things like monetary policy and urban development were simple, and it wasn't intuitive why we needed a study of administration when we already had political science. Yet Western Europeans had already started working on a science of administration. However, Wilson was concerned about the growth of US political science without departments of public administration because he predicted that it would lead to a world in which there are many intelligent critics of government, but few with the skills to correct for what is being criticized. In the words of Wilson, "It is getting to be harder to run a constitution than to frame one." The extent to which this had an impact on government led Wilson to see the local governments of his time as poisonous atmospheres, the states as being contaminated by crooked secrets, and Washington as corrupt. It should be of no surprise that he found these administrations failing to live up to their purpose, that purpose being the execution of public policy with the least cost either of money or of energy. Administrators would be essential in order to accomplish this task. Elected officials, particularly at the federal level, just don't have the time to obtain the comprehensive education that would be required in order to best execute every single law. Even if they could achieve such education, there are just not enough elected officials to do all of the work that is required by administrators, be that CIA agents, financial specialists, firefighters, or even public school teachers. Administrators are important not just to execute public policy, but also to educate elected officials about problems that are going on within the government. Whether or not it is intuitive, policymakers may become ignorant about problems going on within public service if administrators are not providing enough intelligence. It is the job of the administrator to educate the politician, even when they refuse to listen to things like reason and evidence. The extent to which administrators have been able to do this has largely depended on the time in which they have administered. Wilson saw the history of administration to best be divided into three eras, separated by the forms in which power was concentrated at those times. The first is absolute power, in which monarchs have dictatorial authority. The second is constitutional power, in which there are systematic limits on authority. And the third is sovereign people's power. This is the result of constitutional power, and it allows the people to achieve their own vision of public service. Keep in mind that this is an oversimplification, but it does serve our purpose of better understanding differences in administration between monarchies and democracies. Absolute rulers were countered by constitutions, and those very constitutions empowered people to administer function as a means to exercise their will. This did not always mean that progress had occurred. Wilson found many elements of monarchy to be even more efficient, particularly the number of people who must be persuaded in order to make change. In monarchies, this number is one, as opposed to democracies, in which we must persuade the new monarch that Wilson referred to as public opinion. Under the old monarch, progress was prevented by selfishness, ignorance, and fear, while public opinion is composed of masses of people expressing all of those qualities that can really only make decisions as a voting majority of several million heads. For a king or queen, the truth need only be made clear, while for the general public, it must be made commonplace. Persuasion can be difficult in any system, but a society of sovereign people also have to overcome the problem of identifying blame. In the days of monarchy, the public knew that the monarch was to blame. But in the modern world, even the highly educated debate the sources of administrative ills. It is difficult to persuade millions and to identify blame in the system, but there is also another factor at play. The public lacks expertise. Wilson saw criticism by the public as a clumsy nuisance, a rustic handling delicate machinery. At the same time, the main principle that Wilson insisted upon was that administration in the United States must at all points be sensitive to public opinion. You can probably understand why Wilson has received flack over whether or not the values and opinions of the public ought to be validated. but some of this flack simply stems from his acknowledgement of the similar concerns in administration between monarchies and democracies. Wilson knew that we still needed to learn from the past in order to best understand how to do things in the present, even in a system in which the consent of the public is mandated. That being the case, having quickly made decisions by a single person cannot be the standard by which we hand over all of our political power. Still, Wilson saw public opinion as a necessary inconvenience, and even asserted that wherever regards for public opinion is the first principle of government, practical reform must be slow, and all reform must be full of compromises. On one hand, this makes a lot of sense. After all, there are a lot of stakeholders in society, and it would be great if we could all get along. But on the other hand, to delay a solution is to defer it. Slow compromise doesn't seem very intuitive when we deal with things like poverty and terrorism. So where does this leave us? No matter where you stand on public opinion or the politics-administration dichotomy, Wilson's The Study of Administration brought questions to the limelight that political scientists of the age were simply putting off. What role, if any, should the public play in settling administrative cases? They already settle criminal cases by jury, although administrative cases are not ones that the founders predicted would be of the consequence that they are today. Ultimately, we must decide what role the public plays in conducting administration. So let me know what you think. To what extent do you think that public administration is a science separate from politics? If you find yourself skeptical of administrative science, ask yourself if you think that political science departments are doing enough to provide the skills that are required to manage the government.